U.S. Secretary of Defense Lloyd Austin back in the hospital again. The Pentagon says Austin has symptoms suggesting a bladder issue. The announcement comes weeks after previous hospitalizations he had kept secret. Austin effectively vanished from the public eye for treatment for prostate cancer in December and again in January, concealing both the diagnosis and treatment from President Joe Biden and the rest of the government. This time, the public was alerted around 2 hours after the 70-year-old was sent to the hospital, with the Pentagon saying the White House, military, and congressional officials had all been notified. Israel strikes Gaza's Rafah city, killing at least 37 people. The strike comes even after U.S. President Joe Biden told Israel not to attack Rafah without a credible plan to protect its civilians. Local health officials said the bombings hit as people in the refugee camp slept, causing widespread panic. A ground invasion is now feared to begin soon. Over 1 million Palestinians who were forced out of their homes by Israel's invasion are sheltering in Rafah. While Hamas warns a ground offensive in Rafah will torpedo ongoing negotiations for a truce and hostage release. Negotiators had been working on a phased framework deal to release the remaining hostages. A senior U.S. official said they have made real progress over the last few weeks. Qatar, Saudi Arabia, and Egypt, who have mediated truce talks, also warned of dire consequences of Israel's military assault on Rafah. A narrowly divided U.S. Senate advances the $95.34 billion aid package for Ukraine, Israel, and Taiwan. This despite growing opposition from Republican headliners and former U.S. President Donald Trump. The Democratic-led Senate cleared the latest procedural hurdle and moved the foreign aid measure forward toward an ultimate vote on passage expected in the coming days. The Senate passage would send the bill on to the Republican-controlled House of Representatives.
It is essential we finish the work on this bill. It's been years, perhaps decades, that the Senate has taken up a standalone bill that so significantly impacts not just our national security, not just the security of our allies, but the very security of Western democracy and our ideals. Ukraine is dangerously low on supplies, including ammo and air defenses. If America doesn't assist Ukraine, Putin is all too likely to succeed, as President Zelensky repeatedly has reminded us. The only right answer to this threat is for the Senate to face it down unflinchingly by passing this bill as soon as we can.
Former U.S. President Donald Trump at the center of another controversy. During Saturday's rally in South Carolina, Trump said he would encourage Russia to do whatever it wants to members of the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, or NATO, which are not spending enough on their defense. Trump has regularly criticized Washington's NATO allies for not meeting a goal of spending at least 2% of GDP on defense. As president, he also privately threatened multiple times to withdraw Washington's membership from the organization.
NATO was busted until I came along. I said, everybody's going to pay. They said, well, if we don't pay, are you still going to protect us? I said, absolutely not. They couldn't believe the answer. They asked me that question. One of the presidents of a big country stood up and said, well, sir, if we don't pay and we're attacked by Russia, will you protect us? I said, you didn't pay? You're delinquent? He said, yes, let's say that happened. No, I would not protect you. In fact, I would encourage them to do whatever the hell they want. You got to pay. You got to pay your bills. You don't pay your bills, you get no protection. It's very simple.
Top Western officials criticizing former U.S. President Donald Trump following the statements he made on NATO and Russia. NATO Secretary General Jens Stoltenberg said Trump's remarks undermines global security and puts American and European soldiers at risk. He also vows a united and forceful response to whoever attacks the Western military alliance. The White House, meanwhile, rejected comments made by Trump, calling them appalling and unhinged. It also said Trump's remarks endanger American national security, global stability, and the U.S. economy. European Council President Charles Michel also weighing in, saying reckless statements on NATO's security will only serve Russian President Vladimir Putin's interest. Rivals turned partners for the common good. Mining giants in Australia are teaming up for a project that has the potential to reduce the carbon footprint of the steel making industry. Take a look.
Australia's two largest iron ore producers, Rio Tinto and BHP Group, are teaming up with the country's largest steel maker, BlueScope Steel. They announced a pilot green iron project that could help slash the emissions for steelmakers around the globe who rely on Australian iron ore. The production of steel, a key material for infrastructure and the net zero energy transition, currently contributes around 8% of global carbon emissions. If successful, the Green Iron Project could help cut the carbon footprint involved in preparing iron for steelmaking. The company say part of the project could cut emissions by more than 80%. It will involve building the country's first electric smelting furnace, or ESL. Green Iron will also incorporate work that Rio and BlueScope have been doing. The two companies are trying to replace the use of coal with green hydrogen, known as direct reduction. This is meant to reduce the emissions of greenhouse gases in iron ore processing. Tanya Archibald is BlueScope Steel's chief executive of Australian Steel Products.
We've agreed to work together to develop a pilot facility focused on direct reduced iron and electric smelting technology.
However, Archibald says the pilot would need to run for several years, so commercial production is unlikely before the 2030s. Costs for the project will be shared equally, although the companies declined to provide any estimates. Simon Trott is chief executive of Rio Tinto Iron Ore.
Now, the Australian iron ore industry feeds the world steel industry, and that industry is decarbonising. We need to ensure that iron ore from Australia is well positioned for a green steel future. And that is what today is all about. We know that we can't solve this issue alone. We need to partner with others to find a solution.